So what you're looking at is a plant leaf, or a part, a tiny, tiny part of a plant leaf. It's from a leaf of a tobacco species called Nicotiana benthamiana. It's not that important, but it's actually an Australian species. And we use it because we can introduce genes and proteins and either test their function, so what they're doing, or where they go within cells, which is quite important for their function. If you want to be cured, you go to the doctor. Like, leaving your house to go to the pharmacy or the doctor will result in something different than if you go to the bakery, right? So it's not just about going out and doing something, it's about where you go to be able to do the thing you're trying to do, right? So it's really important that a protein ends up in the right place to be doing the right task. So the different visuals, so these things here that look like lips, they're called stomata or stomates, and they're basically the, I don't know if you can see this sort of the middle of the lips here, but that's actually a hole. Yep. And okay. That's where water and air can come in and out of the plant. And the plant can regulate this by closing it or opening it to let water and air in or out, right? So for example, if it's water stress, like if it's really hot, it would tend to close it to preserve water. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, water evaporates, right? But it also needs to have them open because it needs to get air inside, because it needs that CO2, that carbon dioxide, to be able to make energy, right? So it's kind of a balance between letting air in and not losing too much water. So it's really important that's regulated. So that's one thing, and they're a feature that you find on lots and lots and lots of plants, right? Mm-hmm. And they have a similar shape. They vary a bit from species to species, but they're easily recognizable. And so the other things you can see, there's sort of like sinuous lines. They're outlines of a cell. So for example, if you follow my mouse, mm-hmm. this here.
Yep.
That is delineating a single cell. So that's one. So inside that is one plant cell, right? And then you've got here, you've got another one, right? So yeah. You're looking at multiple cells within this space, and the line itself is the cell wall, which is, plants have a cell wall, which is made of mostly cellulose and lignin and things like that. And it's kind of a rigid structure, which animals don't have. So when we have two cells touching each other as a human, there's no cell wall in between them. That's something that's one of the differences between plants and animals. And that's that constrains the shape of the cells and their ability to grow, of course, right? It's kind of like think of it as a box, right? You sort of, if you want to grow, you have to make the box bigger, right, before you can actually grow. And then, so that's one cell wall. And then you have these bright dots here. Mm-hmm. They're the nuclei. So the nucleus of each cell, that's where the DNA is.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So that's why you have one here for this cell. Mm-hmm. Then you have another one here for this cell. You have another one for this smaller cell. And there should be just one per cell. And so that's what you see.
So I wasn't expecting the cells to be all such different shapes. I kind of had this idea that cells would have some uniform structure, but
no. So that's a really
beautiful.
So I guess the first cells, like at the very beginning of the development of a human or a plant or whatever, they don't really have a specific, they don't have an intricate shape like this. But this is this process called differentiation, which is basically that you have, so in your body, you have neurons, you have muscle cells, you have skin cells, and all of these are like, you have gut cells, they all have a different function. And to be able to have that different function, they usually have a different shape, right? That kind of fits the purpose. The neurons have these long tubes called axons that they use to transfer information. A muscle cell doesn't need that, it needs other things. A skin cell doesn't need that. Like, skin cells need to be tightly connected so that you actually have a barrier, right? That protects you from the environment. Whereas neurons need to have these long extensions so they can connect to other cells, right? So here, these cells are intricately connected like this, probably to form a tight barrier. Right, it's kind of a, so we call them jigsaw puzzle, because they look like this. So just underneath, actually, so this is really interesting, because we're getting into like what the colors mean, right? There's actually multiple layers that you're seeing right now. So the very surface of the, so imagine, how do I do that? Okay, so imagine this is what we're looking at from the top, right? That's the surface of the leaf. But actually, if you look at it the other way, you've got one surface on this side and one surface on this side, and that's the inside of the leaf, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you're actually looking from the top here, but you're looking at maybe this far down. So
you've got
multiple layers.
I see.
Right?
Yeah.
So the lips here, the nuclei and those lines here, they would be the first layer, right? That's the barrier layer, the layer that protects the leaf from the outside. But then actually underneath it, you have another layer, and you can start to see. So this here, I don't know if you can see this blob here or this blob here.
Yeah.
So this is actually the cell layer that's underneath it.
Right.
And they actually have a different shape. They're actually, if you think of the surface cell here. So these cells are called epidermal cells, like on our skin, right? The epidermis and then dermis.
Oh, yeah.
So epidermis is on the outside. So they're like this, and then underneath you've got cells that would be like this, right?
Okay.
And so that's why you start to see the tip of some of them popping through here, right? If I go deeper in this, you'll stop seeing this, and you'll see just these cells, right?
Gotcha.
So there's a lot in this image, right? Now let's make it even more complicated.
Yes, please.
So these strings here, they go across the cells.
Okay.
So they're actually part of the solution that makes the cell, right? The kind of liquid of the cell in which the proteins are and everything, right? And plant cells have this big kind of balloon in the middle of the cells that pushes everything against the cell walls. That's why actually most of that looks empty, because this is basically a big balloon that's like blown out against the cell walls, and basically, it's called a vacuole. It's pretty much full of water. And so that's why, like, you know, salad is actually full of water, because actually nearly all of that is just water with some sugars, some minerals, some this and that.
So
much water in it, right? And that's what actually keeps the shape of the cells. There's this sort of balloon that pushes on the outside of the cell wall. And these things are just going across to be able to connect different parts of the cell. Right, so they're sort of like going through the balloon without piercing
it. Yeah, to kind of hold it all together. No, I love it to kind of hold it all together, because it's mostly water. So do they act as kind of keeping the whole thing together?
The water is enclosed in a balloon, so there's a membrane on the outside, right?
Yeah.
And but it means that if you want to travel from here to here, you technically have to go all around, right? So these strands here, they basically travel through, and they're like a highway that allows things to move across the cells in different ways. So if you look through, you'd have some here, some here, some here. So they're kind of these connecting tubes. Now, one last thing is, what do the colors mean, right?
Yeah.
So if you looked at this with the normal microscope, you'd just see green.
Okay.
Right,
yep.
Because that's, I mean, if you grab a leaf, I don't know if you've got plants around you, but like, I can see it behind, right? It's mostly green, sometimes a bit of white, but that's green, and that's because of the chlorophyll. So the chlorophyll is found in those tiny discs that are inside the cells, in particular this one. Actually, all these black areas here, that's the negative imprint. That's where there would be an organ here full of chlorophyll. There'd be another one here. There'd be another one here. There'd be another one here. So they're called chloroplasts, and they basically capture the sunlight, use water and CO2, and make energy, right? So if you look at a leaf normally, with a normal microscope, or with your bare eye, all you see is green. But there's that thing that's quite magical, is that it is green because it absorbs So, okay, so if you think of white light, so the light that we've got from the sun or the light you've got from your incandescent or LED, you know, light bulb just above you, it's yeah. basically all colors of the rainbow.
Okay. Right?
So it's all colors of the rainbow. And the reason why we see rainbows in the sky is that is after it rains, that light actually, when it goes through the water that's in the air, it gets diffracted. So all the colors that are in that white light just get separated and you get to see them individually. So you get purple, blue, green, yellow, orange, red, right? That's the range we can see. Normally we don't see it, it's all together and it looks white. But when it goes through water, because these colors have different properties, they get separated and you actually see a rainbow. So here, what we're doing is we're actually utilizing the fact that light is made of different colors. And we pick, say, we're going to use blue light and we're going to use red light. And we shine only blue light or red light onto this leaf. And the unique properties of what's in different parts of the cell and what's a different part of the plant react with this light. And some part will light up and some part will not. And that's called fluorescence. So some parts will absorb this energy, this light, mm-hmm. get excited. It can't stay excited. It needs to release this energy. And it releases this energy in the form of light. And that's called fluorescence.
Right.
And so, for example, here, different parts of the cell would react differently. Right. Mm-hmm. Now, the last, so that's called fluorescence or confocal microscopy. It's pretty intense, but that's just the gist of it. The last thing you need to know here is that I've actually used a dye here. So I've injected a dye, and that's why you see this sea of blue. It's because, do you remember how I said like these have pores and the air and water can come through? Mm-hmm. That means that underneath, within that leaf, there's actually an airspace, right?
Okay.
And I've filled most of this airspace with this dye, and that's what you see in blue here. And the parts that are in black are parts of the airspace that haven't been filled.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep.
Now, what is really, and this is probably getting too complicated, but what is really cool here is that both the pink and the blue colors are due to the dye. And that's because, so the dye has also gone into the nuclei, it's also gone into the cell walls and all that. But because this dye is special, it changes properties with the pH. You've heard of the pH? And it can go between acidic and alkaline.
Okay,
and,
yes.
And water is neutral in the middle. So lemon is acidic. Coffee yes. is acidic.
Yes.
Water is pretty neutral. And then soda, baking soda, or bicarb is very basic.
Okay.
Right. So what's really special about the different parts of the plants is that their pH is different.
Gotcha.
And that's for a number of reasons. For example, for these cell walls to grow, they need to be acidic. So that's why, but when it's just in the airspace like this, it's actually more basic. So when it's more basic, it's blue. When it's more acidic, it's pink.
Okay.
So it's going to be
basic is another word. Sorry, basic is another word for alkaline.
Yes. Sorry. Yes. It's more alkaline. Let's keep alkaline. Yeah. So it's more alkaline. So that's what's in this image, right?
Right.
And the reason, and that's probably not what you want to put in the blog because it's way too complicated, but this is just for you, like, you know, to walk you through the different layers that are in this image. Now, there's another layer which is that normally you would not expect the dye to go into the nucleus because the dye can't go through membranes. The reason why it's going into the nucleus is probably because the membranes of the cells are broken. So probably when either the cells were stressed or when I introduced the dye, I must have broken some membranes and it's gone inside the nucleus as well, right? So so that's what's behind this image. So
wow. So back to the alkaline and acidic. So when you've put in the blue dye, has it come up pink because it's more acidic or more alkaline than the other parts of this cell?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So basically,
that's awesome.
Yeah. So it's and that's why I was using it. But that was one of the very first. Actually, I think it was the first time I used it. Mm-hmm. And so it was one of the first images I captured, and I thought it was beautiful. So I'll take. And I was actually told by someone, "Oh, you should put in an image for this competition." And I thought, "Well, I'm just imaging that. Maybe I'll do something about this." So that's you know, that was just serendipitous. This image per se can't be used for science because it's not really answering any question, you know. But it was just, we were experimenting with this dye and we thought, oh, that looks really good. And so the basic thing is, like, I've injected a dye in the airspace of plant leaves. Mm-hmm. That dye has chemical properties that means that it reacts differently when it's in an acidic or an alkaline environment. And we can visualize this with these special lasers. And when it's acidic, it will be pink, and when it's more alkaline, it will be blue. So what it is you're looking at plant leaves. You're looking at mostly the epidermis, so the very outer layer, right? And you can recognize the cell walls here. So that's really good. As you said, this and this and this and this, they're all sort of highways that go through that vacuole, which is this balloon full of water, right? And the difference, the reason why this looks drastically different is two things. One is we're not using the dye, so I haven't filled their spaces or anything. Mm-hmm. Instead, we're tracking a protein that has a fluorescent tag. So it's basically, it's got a tag attached to it. So whenever you can see the tag, you know that you're looking at the protein because they're attached to each other. Now, this protein is expressed, when we say expressed, it means it localizes in that, what I was saying, that sort of fluid that fills the cell. So imagine you've got the balloon, you've got the hard cell wall, which is on the outside. And then between that, there's this sort of soup. It has proteins, little organelles, and things like that, right? This is where the action takes place. And so literally this protein is expressed in that soup. And so that's why those streams look actually quite big compared to the previous image, because the previous image was just the dye who had sort of sneakily gone in. So you only had a little bit of it. Whereas here, you should see a lot more of it because you're actually highlighting, you're basically making that soup glow. This is exactly what it is. You're making that soup glow. Right.
Okay.
Now, why do you have these different colors? You are onto it. It is because I've taken what we call a stack. So same thing with the previous image. I've taken actually, if you go back to that block, right? Mm-hmm. I've taken an image here, 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 an image here. You see, and I keep going down. And then you can actually put that together. Right? And that's what I've done here. Except that I've particularly, because we're looking at just one protein, one type of protein. If I don't do anything, it'll be either green or yellow or whatever I want it to be because it's false colors. But here, what I've done is I've said, okay, well, the uppermost planes, the ones that are the most on the outline, would be, let's say, yellow. And the ones most at the bottom would be blue, and between will be a gradient. So what you're seeing basically is kind of giving you an indication of depth. When you go from yellow to blue, you go, I can't remember which way, but you go from the surface to deeper or the opposite.
Right? Yeah, beautiful. Yeah.
So this in itself is not very useful. It just looks good, but it's not very useful, right? So if I was using this image for science, I would probably pick a single part, and I would just have one color because I just did that because it looked great, and I think it looks like there's a scary monster here. So. And the reason why you can't see, okay, so there's a couple more things you can see if I tell you where they are.
Yeah.
So you can see how, like, you've got these little black things within that stream.
Okay.
Can you see that? There's a little black dot. There's a little oblong thing. There's a black line in the middle of that. And you can see some here as well. Okay, so remember how I told you, like, it's highlighting that soup?
Yes.
Well, that soup has little organelles in it, like mitochondria, things like this that make energy, chloroplast. There's probably a chloroplast in here, or actually in here.
Yeah.
And this could be mitochondria or Golgi, other organelles. And so these don't glow. So you just see them black, and then around it is all glowing. So that's why you have this, what I said, like negative imprints in a way.
Okay.
You know, so there's one here. So there's probably a chloroplast that sits in here, and then the soup around it is glowing.
Mm-hmm.
And technically, that's why you can also see things like, it's a bit hard because it's a depth thing, but the black line in between here is probably where the cell wall is. So you've got the soup next to the cell wall on one cell, and then the soup next to the cell wall on the other cell, and they both glow, but the cell wall itself doesn't glow. So you get a black line in the middle.
Okay.
So that's what you're looking at here.
Mm. And what about the red?
So the red would just be another plane. So the leaf will not be flat. It will not be like this. It's probably a little bit like this. So then when you start imaging, the first plane might just cut this corner and then nothing else.
Oh, yeah.
So maybe it starts at red rather than yellow. Maybe it starts at red and goes to blue.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
And then the yellow is in the middle. So it could be that this corner here was a little bit higher up. And the first plane only cut through that, and the rest was just black. There was nothing, right?
Gotcha.
And then as you go down, you start to cut through the whole part of the leaf.
Mm.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Beautiful. Oh, that was interesting.
Yeah. So, I mean, this is like in way more detail than you need to tell people probably, but this is more like, you know, for you out of interest. Okay, so the first image, we took it as part of an artist project with one of my students.
Yep.
And she was looking at how bacteria go inside roots to form the symbiosis that basically fixes nitrogen. So, you know, nitrogen is fertilizer, basically, is a big problem in ag. Mm-hmm. There's some species of crops that know how to fix nitrogen, to capture nitrogen from the environment. And they do that by creating this interaction with bacteria that are able to do this. And the bacteria live inside the plant roots.
Okay.
And the plant root provides protection, but also sugars and things for the bacteria. So it's a symbiosis. They both benefit from it. And she was looking at how the establishment of this process and how the cell walls are modified during this. And so that's why she was looking at this dye, or she wanted to use this dye, which turned out to be impossible to work with. It's way too difficult. To look at this dye to see changes in pH in the cell wall as they were reacting to these bacteria. And so in this case, I was following a protein to make sure I could target it, send it to the right part of the plant so it could carry its function.